Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dr. Ayodele. I'm part of the AfricaX team, and this is Immigration Stories. This is a platform where we talk about Africans who have moved and made the jump to different parts of the world. In this case, we are talking about Canada. And with me this evening, I have Faith Oloruntoba, and she'll be telling us about her own experience making the trip from her native land in Nigeria now to Mississauga, Canada. Welcome, Faith.
Thank you, Dotson.
Fantastic. So without taking more time, let's jump right into it. Can you just tell us a bit about yourself and your backstory? Everything you are willing to share before the jump, before immigration came into the picture.
Okay, so my name is Faith Oloruntoba. I have a background in communications, marketing, and project management. Project management came later, but I was mainly in, you know, marketing, communications, public relations. So I schooled first in UNILAG. I did, that's University of Lagos. I did my bachelor's in mass communications. And then after that, you know, after serving, I went into public relations, you know, practiced for a while, for about 2 years. And then, you know, decided, you know, went back to school and then decided to travel out for studies as well. So I went to Germany, actually.
Whoa, okay, that's an unusual route. Germany. I hear UK, I hear the US, Australia, yeah. But Germany is like different.
Yeah, so I went to Germany. I did my master's. So it's actually Germany and Denmark, but I spent most of my time in Germany. It was okay. Kind of like a joint program. So, you know.
So that means you learned Danish and German in the process.
I only know how to say hello in Danish, right? And that's hey. But aside that, you know, I learned a bit more of German, right?
Okay.
So, yeah. Yeah. So I did my master's there, you know, in journalism and globalization. And then I worked, right? So I worked, you know, as a, you know, marketing communications specialist, and also in project management as a project coordinator, and then as a project manager as well. So, you know, I was actually settling already in Germany before I head off Canada. And then I was like, why not take the leap, right? You know, the permanent residency is straight. The route was straight for Canada, right? You know, instead of waiting 5 to 8 years in Germany to get.
Okay. That's a while now.
So, you know, I gathered all my savings, everything, you know, and just took the leap, you know. Took the, you know, big step to come to Canada. And then I came here and I realized that project management is very lucrative. Also, you know, I searched for jobs in both marketing and project management, right? So but I got a role as a project first as a project coordinator and then as a project manager, and nice. What I do now.
That's interesting. Nice. So what it sounds to me like the key driver for you was Nigeria, being in the Nigerian environment, been there, done that, and it wasn't working, so you decided I'm out here.
So I wanted to be more globally competitive, right? Because I already did a master's in Nigeria, right?
Yeah.
But I met a couple of, you know, Europeans, and, you know, the way they spoke, like, you know, in terms of knowledge gaps, it was really, you know, a whole lot different, right? Because they've been really exposed to different international systems. So I just told myself that I can as well, you know, just travel. There's nothing to lose. So that was why I decided to apply for, you know, a master abroad. I wanted to experience living in two countries. Just, it was more of experience, right? But as I relocated and as I saw the system, I realized that I wanted to stay. You know, honestly, I didn't
You did not live with the mindset of I'm not coming back. This is good. I ain't going back.
No. I actually left with the mindset of coming back, right? To you know, add my knowledge, right? But when I, you know, but when I went and I realized how good the system is and how much I can benefit from the system, as well as how valued my little contributions are, you know, I decided to stay. And then I started working towards, you know, just getting citizenship or permanent residency, you know, so that I do not have to worry with immigration or, you know, on my back, right? And that was what led me to Canada, right? Because I was trying to figure out, okay, how do I stay permanent in Germany? And then I saw the Canadian opportunity and, you know, I grabbed it, right? You know, because to be honest, a lot of immigrants who are in Europe, many of them try out staying permanently in US or Canada, but when they don't get through, they just stay back. So that was it. And it's been amazing, you know, getting these different experiences, you know, working, you know, as regards work, cultures, you know, comparing it with what we have back home.
So for right now, it's four countries: Nigeria, Denmark, Germany, now Canada.
Yes, four countries.
Cool, that's good. That's some good perspective. So this is a question I ask everybody that I talk to. When you came to Canada, when you got to Canada, what were your first thoughts? When did you arrive? What was the weather like? The people you met, were they as cold as the country? Were they nice people? What was your first thoughts on Canada, basically?
It was winter I came in.
Why are you one of those people that said that I want to start the new year in a new country? Oh boy, we all do that.
No, not at all. My first impression when I came was, you know, friendliness, right? But I think that, you know, let me just put this, caveat that, you know, I was coming from a colder country. When I mean colder, I don't mean in terms of weather. I mean in terms of, you know,
opening, people,
right? People, yes. You know, so Canada was more like a warmer place for me, you know, in terms of people, you know, welcoming and saying, oh, wow, you're here. Wow, nice one. Like, what do you need? You know, what do you need to settle? You know, have you opened your bank account? Have you done this? Have you done that? Have you opened your social insurance, you know, number?
Yeah.
Have you submitted the application? All of that, right? It was very welcoming. And, you know, there are so many resources already for permanent residents to access in Canada, right? So I just took advantage of them. I made calls. So that's really helped. Of course, you know, the country was colder than normal, than what I'm used to, but I was already prepared, right? You know, I was already prepared that, okay, you know, a whole lot of kitting up to protect myself against the weather. But I think the big shock was more on the transportation system, right? It's really public transportation in Canada is bad. Compared to, you know, Germany, right? You know, Germany has a very solid transportation system. Compared to Canada, Germany is better in terms of that. Canada, you need a car, really. But it also depends. If you're living in Toronto, like, you know, downtown, you might not need a car, right?
Downtown, you don't need a car. But once you get out of that, immediately,
once you get out of that part,
10, 15 blocks radius.
That's it. Yeah, so I'll say that was my experience. It was also lonely, right? Because starting afresh with no friends, you know, with no family. I didn't have a family here, no backup, nothing. So it was lonely, but
How close was your closest relative in terms of distance and time zone?
Nigeria, that's
Oh boy.
Okay. Yeah. So
5-6 hours at best.
Yeah.
Wow.
5-6 hours. Yeah. No, not 5-6 hours. It's 12 hours, right? Okay,
no, what I mean is the time difference.
Yeah, time zone. Yeah.
Difference. Yeah. 5-6 hours.
Yeah,
wow.
5-6 hours. Okay. So it's But what I, you know, what I just did is just to, you know, connect with people and mingle, you know, just try to fill in the social gaps and
make friends, bearing in mind that you're professional.
Yes, you know, make friends, also network, right?
Yeah.
And actually, to be honest, you know, when one just lands here, you get so absorbed in looking for a job that you don't really feel that lonely until after you've settled down a bit, and then you begin to realize that, okay, now I have something that is paying my bills. What next? Like, wow, this place is so lonely.
And then you suddenly realize that those evenings are not fun. They're not fun sitting down in front of your TV all by yourself if you have
Exactly.
I get that. I get that. So how many years ago was that now?
I'm a year now.
Okay, so
yeah,
nice.
Almost a year.
So what's it been like in that 11-12 months period, what's your how has the journey been, and what are the things that you've picked up that maybe would be useful for somebody who is considering what you have gone through in the last 12 months?
So on the professional side, it's a lot of learning, and I'm still learning, right? Learning first to be more vocal about what I can do, right? You know, here in Canada, looking for a job, trying to get a better job is you being a career salesman, right? That's what I've learned,
true,
right?
True, all of, you're right.
You have to package yourself, you have to sell yourself, or else they would not know, right? Yeah. So that's what I see as the difference, even between Canada and Germany, right? You know, Germany and Nigeria, we kind of have the same system in terms of self-promotion. Germans don't really self-promote like that, just like Nigerians. We just believe if you work hard, it speaks for you, right? People are the ones that would say, oh, she's hardworking. But in Canada, it's different, right? You have to, you know, package yourself, even to your manager, right? You have to tell your manager, this is where you want to be. This is how you want to, you know, these are your goals. And then your manager will be like, okay, I can help you get there, you know? So that's one thing I had to learn, you know? So even while searching for jobs, working with recruiters, you know, it's more of packaging. It's more of, you know, matching your resume to what they want, you know, doing a lot of panel beating, you know, for those that already have the experience, right? So I had to do a lot of learning, how to create the resume, how to match, how to comport myself in interviews. And I'm still learning, right? Now I'm learning more how to communicate with my team members, you know, and team.
Okay, now that you touch on the subject of communication, which I hear is an area of significant disparity between Nigeria and Canada, what are the key differences that you already can see, and how do you think people can bridge that gap to be able to better position themselves, right, when they are choosing to make a move like you made?
That's in terms of communications, right?
In terms of communication in particular. I know that Nigerians, we are loud. We like to, we like to talk. Even though we don't talk, we don't speak about the issues, we like to talk. We may not discuss the issues, but we like to talk. And our voices are loud. That's how we are, right? But what are those differences that you've seen that people need to bear in mind?
So the first thing is, Canadians are big on politeness. Please, thank you, you know, cautiousness, right? Yeah. So, you know, you want to ask for something, say please, you know, they do something for you, say thank you, right? Mm-hmm. You don't say, oh, bring this thing or do this thing. You say, please, can you please, you know?
Even when you're talking to your subordinates, right?
Yes, even when you're talking to your direct reports. In fact, that is, oh my God, that is so important. Like, I know someone that has been denied, you know, that was denied promotion a couple of times, right, to a managerial role. And then when she asked, you know, she was told that's the issue, right?
Wow.
So that's, so that's very important, right? This kind of cautiousness and politeness in communication. Then also knowing the kind of small talks that are allowed, right? And the kinds that are not allowed, right? Mm. If you want to engage in small talk with Canadians, you know, just ask, you know, how's your family? How's the weather? You know, or general light-hearted politics, right? Like, oh, wow, the election, you know, and they can talk, right?
During election season, you can talk about maybe there's something in the news.
Yeah, exactly.
So that you can just demonstrate that you listen to the news.
Yeah, exactly.
But don't get too serious about it.
No. Yeah. Then also sports too, right?
Yeah, like hockey, not just sports, hockey.
Basketball as well, you know, especially if the Toronto Raptors are in the news, right?
Yes, yes, I'm a big Raps fan, so hey, that's good.
Exactly, you know, so those kind of small topics. But at the same time, there are certain discussions you shouldn't be having in terms of small talks, right? Like certain things about people's culture, certain things about people, in fact, religion is like, you know, don't.
You know, no, off limits.
Yeah, or there's a kind of politics that there's a way you talk about politics that is considered offensive, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, that I would say would be, you know, the differences, right? Unlike Nigeria, where we can talk about all kinds of things and
talk about the president, talk about the governors, talk about their assistants and their deputies, and tell everybody how much we hate them and all that, and it doesn't matter.
Exactly. So I would say, you know, that's another important difference. Then another thing, the third thing that I would say I really noticed is that Canadians can talk with you and gist with you for long, but it doesn't mean you're their friend, right? They can talk with you, you know, at work today, talk, and tomorrow they just pass by you and, you know, they don't even send that they spoke with you so warmly yesterday, right? And then Nigerians go like, I thought, but me and this person spoke yesterday and we spoke warm. This person don't even greet me today. Like, you know, what's going on? Did I do something wrong? Not exactly, right? They just take conversation that day as it comes and they move on. Right, and yep. Tomorrow they can see you. They are not in the mood to talk. They won't talk. They just pass by you, right?
And it's not an issue. It's a non-issue for them.
Something personal, exactly. Right. So don't take it too personal. Don't take personal exchanges. You know, in terms of talking and gisting, too personal. So that's what you know. That's another thing with respect to communications. Canadians love it when you can convey your thoughts well. It's not really about the accent. You don't need to be. You don't need to be speaking. So because I know that you know for job search and interview, some Nigerians feel a little bit of, you know, shyness because maybe they have really strong accents, right?
Yeah.
But it's not really about the accents because we have Europeans who have strong accents too, right? We have French people, we have Italians who still have their strong accents. But it doesn't stop them from communicating, right? It's just to make yourself audible and, you know, confident in what you can do, in how you talk and all, right? So focus less on the accent and more on the message, on, you know, your style of communication and, you know, just being relaxed and confident. That's another thing I would say, right? If you're living in big cities, you know, many of those Canadians, they are used to foreigners. You know, they are used to English, you know, so don't feel too self-conscious that, oh, you know, this person would think, not exactly. Many of them have probably met a lot of Nigerians and Indians and Jamaicans and, you know, so relax.
Although I still spell my name every time somebody asks, though. I've met people who now pronounce my name and they give me Ayodele or Ayodele. Right, but it's still what's your name? Ayodele. That's what I just spell by default now. That's what I do. But I'm meeting more people who were after spelling, they pronounce my name and they're close to. Right. Okay. And I let it. So I'm like, okay, it's getting better around here. So that's definitely a huge plus. Now, I think there was one other thing that was coming to my mind in terms of terms that we use that may have different meanings. Right. The way we say you say something in Nigeria and it's like, oh, yeah, that's fine. That was a normal inquiry. And you say it here and it's like, sorry.
One good example is, how was your night? Don't ask anybody. Like, seriously.
I had this sneaky feeling that was the one you were going to end up with.
I had sex with my husband. And then the next thing is, oh, okay. You know, the thing about Canadians is they are very open, right? Like, when you say, how are you? They don't take it like a courtesy. They actually answer you like, oh, how are you? Yeah. Oh, I'm doing fine. Oh, I went shopping. Oh, I did this, right? So when you say, how was your night? It's like, oh, okay. I mean, I had sex with my husband. Oh, I slept on this side of my bed, and you know, it becomes awkward. Don't ask that, right?
So those are examples of things that don't translate. Just once you cross the border, just leave it. Move on.
Exactly. You know, they can be embarrassing. Reverse. I know another question that a lot of Canadians ask that some may not like is, where are you from? In a way that, you know, but that's the opposite anyway. Immigrants, right? Yeah. Or, oh, you speak good English. And I'm like, of course.
That kind of rubs me off wrong these days. Right. When people tell me I speak English, I'm like, come on. All my education was in English language from age 4 till date. There's nothing, you know, there's nothing fancy about me speaking the English language well. But hey, it's one of those things.
Yeah. Nice. So, yeah, nice. I mean, so, questions like that, yeah.
So if I'm hearing you well, it's, last 12 months have been interesting. Learnings, fantastic. Meeting people, the network is growing. There are things that translate and there are things that do not. And you are finding them out on a daily basis.
Yes.
And I think that's great. I'm happy to hear that. And so is there anything that you actually wish you knew before you left Nigeria or before you left Germany in terms of, you know, making this move? Is there anything that you're like, if I actually knew this, either I would have reduced my time or would have reduced the number of attempts I made, or I wouldn't have been banging my head against this brick wall, that kind of thing?
I would say more of the financial landscape.
Okay.
You know, just understanding how to manage my finances, right? If I had researched a little bit better before I came, I would have known how to allocate my resources as soon as I came here, right? Mm-hmm. But then I don't judge myself too much because I was more focused on getting a job, which is more important in terms of paying the bills. Yeah. And then also, I would say for me in particular, because I gave more attention to, okay, so I got a job in my field before I start, you know, so I was planning that if I didn't get a job in my field, I would go to school, right? So okay. I was running both plans at the same time, mm-hmm. right? But I gave more
job energy. Hunting at the same time, school hunting.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, but okay. I gave more energy to school hunting and, you know, preparing myself than searching for a job in my field, right? Mm-hmm. So I started focusing on searching for a job in my field a little bit late, but I got lucky, right? So I got into my field before the school started, and then I just, you know, left the school like, yeah,
just told them, yeah, I got PR, I really don't need to do school anymore.
Yeah, PM actually, like project management, right?
Okay, okay.
So sometimes I think if I channeled my first 3 months into aggressively searching for a role in my field, I might have gotten it earlier, right? Maybe. So for people that have years of experience in their field, I usually advise spend the first, like, just give yourself a target of first 3 to 4 months. Channel your energy in getting a job in your field. You most likely will get one. It might not be the high, it might not pay high at first, but once you get a foot in the door, you can grow from there, right? That's for people that are not transitioning in terms of changing careers or trying to get years of experience. Yeah? You have people that have years of experience in fields that they can translate here immediately, right? Yeah. So if they can afford it, of course, right? If they have the money to say, okay, I would use my money to pay my bills for the first 3 months and then channel my energy in looking for a job in my field. Right, but if not, it's also okay to say, okay, I'll take a job to pay my bills, but I'll make a sacrifice to, you know, accelerate my job search as well while, you know, working, you know, those jobs just to pay bills, you know. I don't really have, so to be honest with you, and I'm not trying to brag or anything, I don't really have that much regret in what I should have done before I came, because I think I ticked many of the boxes. I started networking before I came. I started.
Okay, you know, big one. Networking is huge.
Yeah, I started looking for jobs before I came. Not as aggressively, but like at least one. I started, you know, taking some courses on, you know, settlements, like pre-arrival courses before I came. So,
okay. You know, so yeah, did you use any of the AfricaX resources, you know, like all the pre-arrival articles we have on pre-arrival for organizations within Ontario or any of those kind of things?
Yeah. I mean, so I was already in a group where the Africa Extended were shared a lot. So I read a lot, you know, about it as well as other resources, you know, so that's nice. Helpful. Yeah, and that's something, nice. You know, a lot of people should do as well. Just read.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Go to the website.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
So basically, are you telling me that as far as you're concerned, there's not, you won't do anything different? Give me one thing that you will do different, looking back, hindsight, 2020. Just one.
Just one.
Just one.
Oh my goodness. Travel more before I came, before COVID hits me.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I'll do. Or maybe write my PMP faster. So for those that are planning certifications, you know, if you can speed it up, just like if you know what you're going to do in Canada, right? Maybe you kind of have already gotten the information before you came, right? And maybe one of the requirements is to prepare for a certification. My advice would be do it or start preparing for it before you even land, right? Because once you land, there's so many things about settlements that will not even give you time.
I'll be hitting you in the face that you won't be able to see. Time to study will just not be there.
Exactly. And then if you have a family, it's even more complicated because you're more concerned with taking care, you know, ensuring that they don't lack, right?
Yeah.
And trying to settle them in. So that's what I would say, you know, and you know, using just the time to Yeah, using the time before coming to relax. It was easier for me because I'm single, so I don't have responsibility. which is good.
Yeah, good. You're right.
So it's very easy to make some mistakes and quickly recover to say, oh, well, it's just my mouth to feed. It's okay, right? But with a family, I think a lot more should go into preparations. Packing, take a lot of food, a lot of food and a lot of winter clothes. Unless African natives might not need it here.
You will not need the natives, actually. And by the time you get here, you find out that they are two or 3 years old when you finally have the time to open them up. And you're like, doing this. And then you get new ones in town. So that makes sense. That makes sense. So now for at the end of the day, for me, the essence of this conversation is to see how we can just share perspectives that will help people to be able to make an informed decision about whether they're coming or not. So in your view, assume that I'm that guy who's still in Lagos, he's written IELTS and he's passed it finally, and he's ready to, put in the paperwork because he's getting into the pool now. What kind of thing? Where should I be looking at? Where should my attention be? What should I be focusing my energies on to make sure that when I hit the ground, I'm hitting the ground running? So you talked about making up my mind what I want to do in Canada. So if it requires a certification, I'm either studying for it or I write it and get it done, particularly if it's something global like PMP or CBAP or something like that.
All the IT, all the technology
related certifications, whether it's coding, whatever space you are in that realm. So if I've made up my mind, I'm studying for whatever it is that is certification required, what else should I be thinking about? What else should I be giving attention to, bearing in mind that I'm clearly in a space where probably in the next 12 months, I will be here? Right. So what are those things that you can point at that I should be giving attention to and looking at?
Money, right?
Money. Okay.
In Lagos, right? from the moment you get your ITA, you need to begin to cut down your expenses a whole lot. Like, cut down your expenses, because the money you have saved over, those months that you are waiting until you come here, you'll be able to use it to survive here, just in case, in the first few months, you don't really get a good job, right? Yeah, so that should be the first thing immediately. Like, okay, how do I cut my expenses? That wedding that we're supposed to go, do I really need to buy that ashwebi? Considering that I may not use that ashwebi in Canada that I'm coming to, all those responsibilities that you're carrying outside your immediate family, do you, can you just explain to them that there's something major I'm doing and there's, I'm kind of cash tight now, can you just be patient? Just find ways to cut down your current expenses so that you can save a lot of money here, right? Because when you come, you now realize that aside from day to day, bills taking, a lot of your money,
saving just realize that your annual rent is your monthly rent in Canada.
Shocker, you look at the prices of things.
Shocker. Yeah. I once had a conversation with somebody and it was like, I was sending half a million naira equivalent to Canada and that was their monthly rent. And he was like, I couldn't understand it. I was like, well, you are here now. Do you understand it now? I was like, yes, I get.
yeah, exactly. So that should be the next thing, money. Then just preparing your mind. You see, that mind reorientation is so important, right? I would say it's easier for me because I was living in Germany, right? So coming here, there are a lot of things that will not shock me, right? Like the social life here, but I had that shock when I left Nigeria for Germany. It was a shocker. Mm-hmm. Like, I can't just go to my neighbor's house and knock and be like, oh, please, like, can I get something? Like, you can't just do that here, mm-hmm. right? Nope. Yeah, exactly. So, I would say it's just preparing your mind, depending on what position you are in. So, for instance, you're a father, like, with your kids and all, and typically you have a home where it's the mother that does everything and you just go to work and come back. and provide the money. In Canada, it's not going to be soon, right? You're going to have to split responsibilities. It's expected, right? Or you're the wife whereby you have a lot of family support around you. Your sister can come and clean this one. You know, your mom can come and spend time, you know. Going to Canada, I mean, many women have complained that I feel like I'm a house girl, like I'm constantly doing everything by myself and I still have to work, you know? If you're single and you live the high life in Lagos, like you can easily buy stuff, you can go clubbing, you know, you just have this free spirit. Coming here, you have to conserve. If you plan to, you know, do mortgage, it's even worse because it's only one income. So yes, you know, or if you have plans for settling down, maybe a partner, right? If you have a partner in Nigeria and you're planning to come here, if you want to consolidate it, fine. If you know you don't want to consolidate it, you need to prepare your mind that the dating scene here is not the same like in Nigeria. Yeah. So you need to begin to arrange yourself, you know, all those mental reorientation. Then you also need to really work hard on, you know, preparing yourself that opportunities won't just land on your leg, right? You know, unlike Nigeria, depending on your connections, you know, friend will tell this one, you can get a job here like that. You know, you keep the job for a while. This friend will tell you about this contract. You go to club, you talk, you know, or you know one big uncle. It's not like that here. You know, you just have to do it all by yourself while networking, right? So that's, you know, there's so much work to be done by yourself in entering the labor market. So that mental preparedness, and then the weather too, right? You know, how do I cope with the weather? When do I stay home? When can I go out? If I find myself becoming too isolated, can I take walks out? You know, those kind of mental is very important to get prepared before one comes, right?
There's something that you mentioned briefly there that I want to take you back to. Okay. Networking.
Yeah.
Tell me what your experience has been and how important networking is. I know in Nigeria, we talk about man, no man, and we're like, no, it's a bad thing. You can't do this. You can't do that. Da, 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 da. But here, you suddenly realize that a referral from a friend can get you your dream job, even though, you know, the difference between you and four of the other candidates is that friends say so. So tell me, what's been your experience with networking here, and how important it is in your career in Canada?
So there is this general belief that, it's not even a belief, it's a fact, right? I think 70 to 80% of jobs are not advertised. Right?
True.
Many recruiters tend to reach to their inner circle to say, do you have anybody good to fill this role? And those their inner circle will reach out to their networks to say, oh, do you have, you know, are you planning to get this role? I have a friend or I know somebody advertising for it, right? For us as immigrants, we may not have those, you know, interpersonal networks like friends and family. For some of us, right? Some of us may have, some of us may not. For those that don't have, you have to go out of your way. So like me, you know, even while I was in Germany, I started going on LinkedIn, right? I started connecting with industry leaders, connecting with people that are in roles that I want to get to. And I just started doing information interviews like, oh, hello, my name is Faith. I'm based in Germany. This is my profession. I'm just, you know, kind of researching about the landscape in Canada in terms of work. And I would just like to hear you get your insights because I've seen your profile. And it's amazing, and I admire it, right?
So I want to be like you when I grow up.
exactly, you know, some will answer, some will not. But those that will answer, and, you know, they will give a lot of information. So they gave me a lot of information. In fact, one of them was so amazing to add me to the groups, you know, groups of, you know, other Nigerians in Canada, you know, groups. Wow. You know, it was amazing, really. I wouldn't have gotten that without networking. Even my first job was also through networking on LinkedIn, right? You know, and I sold my skills like, oh, this is what I can do. This is what I can do. We can come to an arrangement and I can do them even while I'm about to land, right? So it's so important for information, for building rapport, right? And, you know, when you follow people on LinkedIn, you know, when there are jobs that are posted, you know, you can easily write on the comments that, oh, I'm interested in this, right? You know, so networking is so important, right? Not most importantly on LinkedIn, because Canadians take LinkedIn so seriously.
Yeah, LinkedIn yeah. Is still considered to be a very strong resource for career and business. So yeah.
Yes. Then also talking. Yeah, and then talking about what you need. Right. You know, in Nigeria, we have this coded style, you know.
Yes, well.
Nobody will tell you anything, you know, they will just be doing it codedly, mm-hmm. and they get it. But here it's not like that. If you don't talk, people will not know and they can't help you, right? Yeah. So, you know, you may not tell the whole world or you may not tell everybody, but it's important to be open to a couple of people that you've been building the rapport with. You don't know who might know someone or who might share an opportunity with you. And then you get it, right? So, you know, it's important to view the networking as most, you know, the primary tool for searching for the job, right? It could be that you're in a school or you're planning to come to school here, right? The alumni network is very important. You know, connect with the alumni, you know, ask them their experiences, tell them what you need. Your program coordinator has access to the jobs within the school. Tell her your plans, you know, I plan to do this. Just in case you see any role, please let me know. You know, those are networks, right? And the beautiful thing about Canada, unlike Nigeria, is that for Nigeria, when you're doing all those networking man-to-man, it's more personal, right?
Yep.
It's more like, I know your uncle, your brother, your distant, your family. But here, it's not really that personal, right? It's more of, this person went to my school. Oh, wow, you went to my school? Oh, wow, okay, interesting. I could, you know, it's not as personal. So it's very easy to penetrate, right? It could be that, we're colleagues in this bank. Oh, I read your book. I've actually connected with a lot of people through, I went to this event and I met you there and you spoke and it's amazing. And they're like, oh, really? Wow, great. Okay, you know, like that, right? It could be a friend or friend that referred you and, So even if you're not naturally outgoing, it's okay. You know, you don't have to be a loud, you know, outgoing extrovert like me to do it. You can be introverted, but you just get more strategic about networking, right? You just tell yourself, okay, if it's about job or if it's about this event or partnering for a particular purpose, I would force myself to come out, right? And then once you're done, you just go back into your show. It's okay, right? So yeah, it's so important. No forming, no, don't be proud. You know, just
just present yourself as you are, respectable, honorable self. Ask questions.
A lot.
If you don't know, there's nothing wrong with saying you don't know.
Yes.
And follow it up with, can you share?
Yes.
People will tell.
Yeah.
I once reached out to somebody for an informational interview like that. Mm. So this was. I'm an accountant by training, and I've spent a lot of time in the accounting world.
Mm-hmm.
And this is somebody who was a CFO of a startup, and he had been in that CFO of a startup role for like four different companies that have been sold and bought and sold and bought over the last like 10, 15 years. I was going to say, hey, you know, I like your profile. You seem to hold this title of CFO well, and everybody seems to be paying you for holding it. Can you just share your experience? And if I had asked him for a job, I'm sure he would have said no.
Yeah.
But because of the kind of question I asked, he gave me one full hour of his time. We sat at the Starbucks in downtown, and all he was just doing was talking about his experience, company after company, sale after sale, how much he made, how much, where he made money, where he lost money, where they bailed them out, as in gave me the whole spiel. So I totally agree with you that, you know, if you ask people, the likelihood, particularly if you are coming off like, you know what, I'm new here and I'm just trying to find my feet. You're not telling them you want a job. You're just telling them, just share your experience with me. They may work in the company you want to work in. They may work in a role that you are working in and just say, hey, just tell me what you know about it. And they will.
Yeah,
they may not be willing to introduce you to the hiring manager yet, not just yet. Maybe after the next coffee, they may consider it because you are persistent and they've seen you more than once, right? That at least that's my own experience.
Yeah, and I also want to say something like there's a difference between introducing yourself, you know, to your network as, okay, I'm just coming to Canada, I'm trying to get use of the landscape, and packaging yourself as an experienced professional. Right, so it's very important not to mix both.
Not to mix
right?
it too.
You understand? So I once connected with someone and she was like, well, actually I did this in Nigeria, but you know, I don't know how to translate it, you know, yet. And I told her, that's amazing. It's fine. Let's talk about your transferable skills. But then I told her, when you are before a hiring manager, you never ever say that. You're projecting yourself as, I'm an expert. I'm coming here with years of experience. I've done a lot of things. I've had a lot of transferable skills and I'm ready to launch it here, you know, so that you can benefit from my international experience. You know what I mean? So, you know, because even the information I interview, they're also watching. They're also, taking those skills, you know? Yeah. So it's more of, okay, I have so much experience. I have so much to offer. I just need to know how to channel it here in Canada. How can you, you know, what has been your experience? How can you help me, you know, tell me, you know? Yeah.
Oh, nice. I've personally found, one, I'm impressed with your experience and how your 12 months have gone. I will say to many more, many more successes, many more victories, both career and business and life in general.
Yeah.
And thank you for your encouragement. Thank you for your support. Thank you for your time. I've enjoyed this conversation particularly. And I will be saying, as we grow, mm-hmm. as you grow, mm-hmm. and as we support the growth of the wider community, the hope is that we just continue to strengthen and enable one another to become better professionals, better individuals, better citizens of our adopted country, Canada.
I agree on that one.
And whether it's money we're investing or time that we're investing or people that we're investing in, that we get a good ROI. I like 50% per annum, but let's see how that goes.
Great. Thank you.
Really, thank you very much for your time. I really appreciate this.
My pleasure. Yeah.